So I hope you can see my screen. As introduced, I am Mihir Dharmadikari. I am a graduate student in the Computer Science and Engineering department. I work at the Autonomous Robots Lab under the guidance of Dr. Kostas Alexis, who is also my advisor for my thesis. Today, I will be presenting my work on autonomous informative path planning for aerial and legged robots. Before I begin, I would like to thank my advisor as well as all my committee members, Dr. Christos Papakristos, Dr. Marco Hutter, and Dr. Hauk Su for their valuable time and guidance. The deployment of robots in high-risk environments is useful in many applications, and hence many research groups have recently focused on resilient autonomy and deployment of such systems in high-risk environments. This research has uses in many domains, such as subterranean exploration, search and rescue, or nuclear site inspections, and many more. A recent and a very good example of this is the DARPA Subterranean Challenge. This was a robotics challenge hosted by DARPA that started in 2018 and had its finale in September 2021. The problem statement given for this was to deploy robots in subterranean environments, such as mines, caves, or man-made structures like subways, and identify and locate certain objects of interest. There were a total of four stages of this competition. The first three were conducted in three different types of subterranean environments, namely the tunnel, urban, and cave environments. And the fourth, the final event, was a combination of all these three. This challenge has accelerated the research in resilient autonomy, and it demonstrated the potential of this research. I'm really honored that I got the opportunity to be part of Team Cerberus and participate in the final event of this challenge. And I'm very proud to say that Team Cerberus won the first place in the final event of this challenge. Now that we know the potential of this research, let's see what we need to do to bring this to reality. First, we need to understand some of the challenges presented by the subterranean settings. First, they are very large in scale. They can be kilometers in length. They have very complex geometry that can involve multiple branches, multiple levels that need to be traversed through either staircases or vertical passages. They can have very narrow passages, less than a meter wide, and at the same time, very open wide areas, like 50 meters by 50 meters. They have very tough terrain, which could include rough terrain as shown here in the figure. And at the same time, they can also have structured yet difficult terrain, for example, staircases. These environments are usually completely dark. They can have obscurants, and they could have self-similar geometries, for example, in tunnels. And all these factors present different challenges to different kinds of sensor. Finally, as the aim is not to send humans in these environments, we don't know where the entities of interest are going to lie in these environments. One of the components of the robotic systems that are going to operate in such environments is the informative path planning that is going to guide the robot and make all the decisions on board the robot. We have identified certain characteristics of such path planning methods for them to efficiently operate in these challenging environments. The first is the capability of long-term autonomy. So the method should not only be able to perform local navigation, but should be able to store information globally and use this global information to make high-level decisions about the planning. Second, it should be aware of the motion constraints of the robots, for example, the traversability constraints for ground robots, as well as limited flight time of aerial robots. It should be generalizable across multiple robotic platforms. And finally, since these robots have different kinds of sensors, and that they give different kinds of information, the planner should be able to optimize for multiple objectives at the same time. Given this background, in this study, we make two main contributions. The first part is an exploration path planner for subterranean environments. This work builds upon a graph-based exploration planner, which is a work from our lab, which was first authored by Dr. Tung Dang. Along with presenting the method, I will also present some results of field deployments of this method. The second part is an adaptive path planning strategy to co-optimize for two objectives, which are volumetric exploration using a LiDAR or a depth sensor, and visual search using a visual camera sensor. Here, we conducted a set of comparative simulation and real-world experiments to study the performance of our method against a purely exploration path planner. Now let's start with the first part, which is the updated graph-based exploration planner. We also refer to this as GB Planner 2. The aim here is to map a given volume that is completely unknown beforehand with a given depth sensor. So the planner provides paths to the robots to maximize the amount of newly mapped volume based on the map it has built so far. The planner works in an iterative manner, so it will calculate a path, the robot will execute it, and this procedure is repeated till the entire environment is explored. As we saw in the previous slides, these environments can be of very large scale, so we can't do a pure global planning in tractable computation time, but still we need to have this global information. So to overcome this, we propose a bifurcated architecture where we have a local planner and a global planner. The local planner is responsible for finding paths to maximize the unknown volume that will be mapped, whereas the global planner is responsible for repositioning the robot to different parts of the environment when the local planner cannot find any informative paths. I will now first go through the local planning algorithm, and then we will go into the details of each step. At every planning iteration, we first identify our volume, which we call the local bounding box, around the current robot's location. And within this volume, we sample a collision-free graph. For all the volumetric calculations like collision checking, we use a framework called VoxBlox. As the local planner operates in a small subset of the map, we can have a good resolution of the map, about 20 centimeters, and have a dense graph to search through. Once we have built this graph, we identify a set of possible paths using Dijkstra's algorithm and evaluate the expected information gain, which relates to the expected volume that will be mapped by the robot if it was to traverse along each of these paths. And once we have them, we select the best path among them, which is given to the robot. Now let's look into each step in detail. The first step is building this graph. And before that, the robot has to identify this local bounding box. For that, the planner extracts an aggregated point cloud around the current robot's location and performs principal component analysis on this. Then the local bounding box, which is here modeled as a cuboid, is oriented along the principal components, as you can see in the figure on the left. And it is scaled by the respective eigenvalues of those principal components. Once we have this bounding box, we sample points in free space within this bounding box and connect them through admissible edges. For aerial robots, admissible edges are simply collision-free straight line paths. However, for ground robots, it is important that these paths also have a supporting ground below them for them to traverse. To check for this supporting ground, we need to project every single sampled point downwards onto the map to check if there is an occupied voxel, which is the ground below them. For that, we cast a ray downwards and see if there is an occupied voxel below it. However, as you can see, there might be some gaps in this map. Now, these are usually caused by the LiDAR rays that hit the ground at a low incidence angle, and hence they are not integrated properly in the volumetric map. To avoid this, or to go around these gaps, we also cast a few more rays around the central ray, and we say that this sample has a supporting ground if any one of these points hits an occupied voxel. To check supporting ground for edges, we interpolate the edge at certain resolution and project all the points downwards on the ground. And apart from checking if there exists a ground, we also ensure that every single segment within this interpolated projected edge has inclination within a certain feasible limit. So in the central figure, all the segments have feasible inclination. However, in the figure on the right, there are two segments whose inclination exceeds this limit. Hence, this edge is not admissible for the robot. Dealing with negative slopes is slightly tricky because they cannot be mapped properly from a further away distance. Hence, to overcome this, we introduce a concept of hanging vertices. These vertices are vertices in free space, but they don't have any ground voxels attached below them, which the planner could find through this projection. These vertices are retained in the graph if they can be connected to the regular vertices by edges which are within the inclination limit. Now, when such a path needs to be commanded to the robot, we don't command the edges connecting to the hanging vertices. So in this path, it will be truncated here at the orange vertex. This is to ensure safety of the robot. Now let's look at the computational growth rates of this first step, which is building the local graph. The first part is the principal component analysis, and it grows linearly with the number of data points used for the PCA. As we are using box blocks for checking the status of a voxel, the query of each voxel can happen in constant time because of the hashing done by box blocks. For sampling a particular vertex, the computation cost depends on the fraction of the free space within the volume that we are using for sampling the vertices. At the same time, we model the robot as a cuboid, and hence we need to check the status of every single voxel in this cuboid. So this cost is also multiplied to the previous one. Finally, checking an edge can be thought as multiple vertex checks at one voxel resolution. Hence, its computational complexity depends on the average number of edges that are connected to a particular vertex, the average edge length, and the size of the modeled cuboid. Finally, for the projection, we truncate the projection at a certain maximum distance, say h max, and hence its computation cost is simply h max over the map resolution, which is the number of voxels that we will check. In the second step, we find the candidate paths from this graph using the Dijkstra's algorithm and calculate the expected volume that will be mapped by traversing along each of them. The expected volume by one particular vertex is called the volumetric gain, and this relates to how much unknown volume the robot will see if it was at that vertex. To calculate this, we want to count the number of unknown voxels that lie within the modeled frustum of the sensor from that vertex. And we do this by doing raycasting from this vertex within the frustum of the sensor. For each of the paths that we have calculated in the last step, we compute the total gain of that path, which is called exploration gain, as formulated here in this equation. As you can see, apart from simply aggregating the volumetric gain, we have two more terms. The term here on the right is the path length penalty, and the function d is the Euclidean distance along the path from the first vertex to the jth vertex. The term on the left is the path direction penalty, and the function z over here gives the similarity metric between the path that we are checking and a pseudo straight line path, which is along the direction of the robot's current exploration. This term over here on the left is used to give preference to the paths that are aligned with the current exploration direction. This is particularly useful when we are in an intersection and we don't want the robot to go back and forth into different branches. As the gain calculation step is the most demanding process, we also have two modifications to simplify this. The first is to calculate the volumetric gain only at the leaf vertices of each of these Dijkstra shortest paths. And the second is we can cluster these leaf vertices and calculate the gain only at one of the vertex and assign that gain to all the vertices in the cluster. To further make the recasting process faster, we have implemented a method called iterative recasting. This is derived from the method described in the paper down here. The main advantage of this method is that it avoids checking the same voxel multiple times by multiple arrays. So each ray that we cast starts from a point that such that the distance of that ray from all the previously cast rays is more than one voxel size. Finally, let's look at the computation costs for the volumetric gain. The Dijkstra's algorithm increases as NV log NV, where NV is the number of vertices in the graph. For the volumetric gain calculation, the cost is purely that of checking all the voxels within this frustum. So it depends on the number of rays that are cast, the maximum length of each ray, and the map resolution. In case of iterative ray casting, since we start at a different point, the ray, maximum ray length changes, and which is accounted by this term over here in this equation. Here we have some quantitative results of comparing the volumetric gain calculation time using different parameters. These numbers are averaged over 100 planning iterations, and in each planning iterations, we have used 500 vertices in the graph. We have selected two different environments. One is a large open room, and the other is a relatively narrow mine. This table gives us an idea of how each of the parameter affects the gain computation time, as well as how the environment can change the effect of each of these parameters. For example, we can observe that the effect of clustering is much more drastic in a smaller environment than in a wide open environment. Finally, once we have calculated the exploration gain for each path, we select the path that has the highest exploration gain, and then we move the vertices of this path slightly away from the occupied region, which you can see over here. The pink path is this moved path. We do this under the assumption that this small change is not going to cause a large difference in the expected volume that the robot is going to map. And once this path is derived, it is given to the robot. The robot executes it, and this process is repeated iteratively. With this, we come to the end of the local planner, and I'll now explain the global exploration planner. My main contributions in this work were in the local planning step, and the global planner is primarily based on the previous work. However, some of the concepts from the local planning step, like the modifications done for ground robot, are also used in global planner. Hence, it is important in this part as well. As you must have noticed, that if we keep continuing the local exploration, we might end up in a situation where we have hit a dead end, and the local bounding box is not sufficiently big enough to guide the robot to the unexplored regions of the map. In this case, the global repositioning part of the global planner is triggered. To reposition the robot, the global planner maintains a global graph, which is built by clustering and adding the high exploration gain paths from the local planning steps, as well as the robot's odometry. And within this graph, the planner identifies vertices which have high volumetric gain and repositions the robot to one of these vertices. Now, the selection of these vertices, which we call the frontier vertices, is complicated because we don't have a good estimate as to how much more exploration can happen from a particular frontier vertex. So we have formulated this global exploration term, which includes the volumetric gain of the frontier, as well as two more terms. The first on the right is the path length to go from the current vertex to the frontier. The term on the right represents an estimated exploration time that will be remaining after the robot reaches that frontier. And this time is calculated as the currently remaining exploration time minus the time it will take to reach from the current location to that frontier and from the frontier to the home location. Finally, when the remaining time of the to the robot is only enough to do one exploration step and return back to its home location here, the homing maneuver in the global exploration planner is triggered, where it finds a path from the current robot location to the home location using Dijkstra's algorithm. Here, I would also like to highlight a key feature that in every local planning step, the planner calculates this homing path to check if it has sufficient time to go back to home. This ensures that the robot always returns home safely in every planning iteration. Now let's look at the computation costs. In the global repositioning step, there are three main factors: the Dijkstra's algorithm, the volumetric gain calculation, and extracting the best path from all the possible frontier paths. As we saw, the Dijkstra's algorithm has the following cost. For the volumetric gain calculation, if we say OG is the gain calculation cost for one vertex, which we have seen in the previous slide, and NF are the number of frontiers, this is the total cost of calculating gain for all frontiers. And finally, extracting the path linearly depends on the number of vertices in the graph. Since the homing only involves calculating the path using the Dijkstra's algorithm, the only cost involved here is that of the Dijkstra's algorithm. Now, let's look at some of the field deployments of the method. I will present a total of 4 experiments, 2 using a legged robot and 2 with flying robots. The first experiment here was conducted in the Hagerbach mine in Switzerland. The robot that is used here is Animal C legged robot, which is developed by a robotic systems lab at ETH Zurich and Anibotics. This was a fully autonomous mission for 40 minutes. And here you can see in this sub video, the path that is given by GP Planner. And at the bottom, you can see the map that the robot has built so far. Here, I would also like to highlight that another lower level planner was used by the robot to track the paths given by GP Planner. This was done because GP Planner uses a relatively low resolution, about 20 centimeters, which is not enough to capture all the traversability constraints that are required for such a robot. And hence, for the safety and better locomotion, this local or low level planner was used. At this point, the robot is traveling along a steep slope. If we fast forward a little, here the robot has now entered a dead end and it has triggered global repositioning. At this point, the state machine onboard the robot re-triggered GP Planner, hence it has gone back to local exploration. And now it is exploring another branch of the environment. Once it finishes this branch, it will trigger global repositioning again. We can move forward a little more. At this point, once it reaches the frontier, it has triggered local exploration again. Here, the robot is going down a negative slope. We can keep fast forwarding. The robot is exploring the remaining branches of the environment. And at this point, the homing is triggered and the robot is returning back to the home location. At this point, the robot has reached the home location. The second experiment was conducted in a natural cave called the Great Saltpeter Reserve, which is in US. This is a natural cave, so it has much more challenging terrain than the previous mine. Here, the robot has started in a corridor and then it enters a big room. This part had a lot of complicated terrain like cliffs and steep slopes. You can see some of the structures from the onboard camera view of the robot. At this point, the human operator triggered global repositioning However, GB Planner planned a path downward, a slope that the robot might not have traversed, and it had, hence the robot had to be manually repositioned to another point, and then the planner was triggered again. It is now exploring a different branch. We can move forward a little more. And finally, at this point, it triggers homing and is coming back to the home location. Here, the state machine on board the robot triggered a recovery homing maneuver where it backtracks the path that the robot has executed so far. Now we come to the experiments with aerial robots. The first experiment here is again in the Hagerbach mine. The robot that is used here is called RMF Oblix. It is a custom designed collision tolerant robot, which has a flight time of about 8.5 to 9 minutes. The total mission duration here was about 8 minutes, which also included autonomous homing. At this point, the robot is performing local exploration, and the map it has built can be seen here at the bottom right. We can fast forward a little towards the end. At this point, the battery has reached its critical limits, so the robot has triggered homing and is now coming back. Once finished, the robot lands. The last experiment was conducted in an underground mine called the Loken mine, which is situated in Norway. This mission is performed by a different quadrotor platform, which is built on top of a DJI Matrice 100 platform. We call this the Alpha Aerial Scout. The robot starts at the beginning of a big room and enters the room and explores that room. Here on the bottom left, you can see the paths of the robot, as well as the graph that you can see here is the global graph built by the robot, where you can see these red circles and the numbers. These are the frontier vertices. And the green path over here is the homing path that the planner calculates in every planning iteration to ensure a safe return to home. And now the robot has fully explored the area. The GB Planner 2 that I described right now is now available as open source ROS package, and it can be found in the GitHub organization of ARL. We have provided detailed documentation of all the parameters, interface, as well as instructions for installation and execution of the planner. There is also a planner control interface which we have provided to interface the planner, the core planner, with other external modules such as the path tracking controller. The overview of this interface can be seen here in the figure. This planner was used by the robots of Team Cerberus in the DARPA Subtee Challenge, and the robots that used this are shown at the bottom. Some of them used the previous version of the planner, which we call the GB Planner 1, and the remaining used GB Planner 2. We have also created two demo simulations, with one with an aerial robot and another with a rover. This allows the users to try out the planner before going deep into the code. Here I have two videos of both of these demo simulations. Now finally, here I would like to present the final round of the DARPA Subterranean Challenge final event, which was the prize round which counted towards the final winner. This shows the deployment of the four Animal Sea robots in the environment that was created by DARPA. Here at the left, you can see all four robots operating in those environments. All the robots are deployed from here, where we have the gate, and no humans are allowed to enter the region after this. The first robot that was deployed was Chimera, and it went into this region, which is the cave. The top part over here is the cave region. And after that, it went into the urban region, which is this part, followed by Cerberus, which was deployed to go into the tunnel, explored some part of the tunnel and the cave environment, and then followed by Camel and Caiman, where the Camel entered the urban and explored a lot of the urban environments, and the Caiman went into the cave, followed by the tunnel environment. With this, we conclude the first part of the presentation. And now we come to the second part, which is the hypergame-based adaptive behavior planner for combined exploration and visual search. In short, we call this hub planner. This planner aims to tackle two objectives. One is the volumetric exploration with a 3D LiDAR, and the second is visually searching this environment with a camera sensor, which usually has a smaller range and a smaller field of view. The planner uses three distinct planning behaviors, which are the exploration and sparse and dense visual search. The planner also works in an iterative manner, just like GB planner. And in each iteration, it selects the best suited behavior from the above three based on the planner's inference about the surrounding environments, as well as its performance assessment about each of these behaviors in the last few planning iterations. First, we will look at the hypergame formulation of the problem. Hypergame theory is an extension of the game theory, and a hypergame occurs when at least one of the players of the game does not know all the strategies in the game. In this work, we consider the robot and the environment as the two players of the hypergame. The robot aims to visually search and explore the environment, and on the other hand, the environment presents certain challenges to the robots. Since the robot can only make some uncertain inferences about these challenges, we think hypergame is an ideal way to model this kind of interaction. For all the decision making and navigation, the planner uses a dual representation of the environment. The first is a volumetric map. In this work, we use box blocks as the volumetric mapping representation. This map is used for collision-free navigation, volumetric calculation, as well as evaluating the areas that have been covered so far. We also annotate the surfaces of the environment seen by the camera in this map by annotating the occupied voxels that lie within the camera frustum. The second representation is a topological graph, and each vertex in this graph represents a point in space, and it stores the beliefs of the planner about the topology around that point. And the two topologies that we consider in this work are a room-like and a corridor-like topology. The behavior selection, which is the core part of this work, happens in two steps. In the first step, we select the main planning mode, which is either exploration or visual coverage. This decision takes place based on three criteria, as they are formulated here. The three criteria are the percentage of mapped surface seen by the camera within the local volume around the robot. The second is the planner's belief about the topology around the current location. And the third is the robot's assessment of the performance of each of these behaviors in the last n iterations. We compute a score for each behavior, which is shown here in these equations. The performance of a behavior in a particular iteration is calculated using the change in percentage of volume mapped by the depth sensor and the change in percentage of the surface seen by the visual camera sensor. And they are formulated here in the equations on the left. The cumulative performance in last n iterations is calculated as the weighted sum of each of the performances after subtracting a threshold value from them. This threshold value is selected such that we say the performance is not good enough if it is below this threshold. And once we have the two scores, we select the behavior that has the higher score among the two. If we select the coverage behavior, the planner has to further evaluate the optimal sub-behavior, which is the sparse or dense coverage. The sparse coverage is tailored more towards well-lit areas and for faster coverage, whereas dense coverage is more tuned for darker environments. Here we compute another score, which depends on the environment lighting conditions and the performance of each of the sub-behaviors. The light condition score is calculated using the camera brightness and is formulated here. The term ID is the fraction of image pixels which have an intensity below a given threshold. The performance term is similar to the performance calculated as shown in the previous slide. Now let's look at the exploration and coverage planners that are used in this method. The exploration planner is similar to GB planner. In this work, it was the previous version of what I presented in the first part, so GB planner 1. Since I have already discussed it in detail, I won't go into the details of this part. However, the new contribution is the coverage planner. This uses a graph-based planner that maximizes the amount of mapped surface that is seen by the camera. It first builds an undirected graph by sampling the position and heading of the robot around within a local space around the robot. And we compute an information gain, which we call the visual gain, for each of these vertices. This gain represents the amount of unseen surface that the camera will see if it was located at that particular vertex. We then select sets of vertices from this graph, and the set that has the highest cumulative visual gain is selected as the best set. And finally, the path to connect all these vertices is calculated by solving the traveling salesman problem. And this path is given to the robot for execution. To evaluate the planner, we conducted some comparative studies. Two of them were in simulation and one real world experiment. The performance metrics that we have used here are, there are two performance metrics. The first is the percentage of total mapped surface seen by the camera, and the second is the total surface that is seen by the camera. The first simulation study is shown here, which was conducted in a cave network. This cave has very large open rooms and is completely dark. As you can see from the plots, the HAP planner clearly outperforms GB planner because of its formulation. On the right side, the figure shows the maps, the final maps of the two planners. The red areas in the maps are both visually seen and mapped by the LiDAR, whereas the black areas are only mapped by the LiDAR but not seen by the camera. The second simulation study was in an urban environment. This is a relatively small environment and it has some big rooms connected by subway tunnels. Because of the small scale, GB planner also does well, especially in the tunnels, which you can also observe in the plots. However, since HAP planner spends time to individually cover each room, we eventually get higher coverage than GB planner. The third comparative study is an experiment in a building in University of Nevada, Reno. The environment considered here starts with a long corridor, then enters a room, another small corridor, and finally a dead end. The light conditions in the room were mostly dark, and the robot had to rely on onboard lighting. Since this is a relatively small environment, GB Planner does decently good here as well. However, since HAP Planner spends time exploring or covering each of the areas carefully, it is able to get higher coverage in the end. At this point in the video, you can see the robot has entered the room and it selects to perform coverage. I will fast forward a little. At the end of the coverage step, once it has covered sufficient volume around it, it goes back into the exploration mode. On the bottom right here, you can see the topological graph built by the robot as well. In the second half of the video, I would like to show the first simulation study that I presented. And this is in the cave. As you can see, GB Planner is in the beginning performs very fast exploration of the environment. However, it has missed a lot of areas to visually cover. On the other hand, HAP Planner spends time to visually cover the areas as well, and hence eventually has a better ratio of exploration and visual coverage. Finally, we conducted one more experiment in the lock and mine that I presented before. This was the same big room that was seen in the previous video. In this, we had made a small modification to the planner, where if the exploration behavior is selected, it will continue the exploration for a fixed number of planning iterations before it again uses the hypergame to select the next behavior. As you can see, if we purely use GBPlanner, which was the case in the last experiment, it will not have these paths that allow the robot to go around and look at the surfaces more carefully. Especially if we look at this kind of behaviors, this will not be observed in case of pure exploration. With this, I would like to end the main contributions of my work. There are some extensions that are possible going into the future. The first being a tightly coupled integration of the traversability constraints into the higher level planning. As you saw previously, the only way the traversability was handled was by having another lower level planner, and there was no feedback from it to the higher level planner. Having such a coupled optimization will improve the performance of the higher level planner itself. Second, we would like to investigate how these methods can be used outside of subterranean domain, as most of these methods have been designed and tuned for subterranean domains. However, the core concepts can be more generalized and used outside of subterranean environments in generalized informative path planning. Coming to the hub planner, the current method only considers the image brightness as the only way of handling visual information. However, more accurate visual interestingness information can make the decision-making process better. Finally, if we have to explore a large-scale environment, then doing it with one single robot is not possible due to the either limitations of the endurance or the mission time limit, as it was there in the DARPA subterranean challenge, or the locomotion constraints. For example, a ground robot can't fly through a vertical passage. Hence, we need a method that can do coordination between multiple robots and a method that runs one level higher than such an informative path planner can guide the informative planner to better optimize when there are multiple robots in the scenario. Finally, I would like to list some of my publications that I have done in the last 2.5 years. Here is a list of the publications in some conferences, and here is the publication in a journal. I would like to thank all my members in the lab, as well as all the team members of Cerberus who have helped me in this work and who have always guided me throughout this 1.5 years. And then finally, I would like to conclude my talk here, and I'd be happy to answer any of your questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mihir. All right, so I would like to ask you now to stop recording from now on.